Have you ever had this thing in your life that you just have no clue how it got there? Like, nobody around you really knows where it came from, but hey, we're happy it's here, I guess. Things like this just simply exist and you enjoy them, whether it be a game, a TV show, a book, whatever. You don't make a big deal about it, but you know that that thing means a lot to you. For me, this certain thing is 1995's classic Golden Boy. Personally, I read a big chunk of the manga written by Tetsuya Gawa before dipping into the anime, and I have no goddamn clue how I heard about this. Like, one day, by divine happenstance, something hit me in my senior physics class and just made me go, today I will titty manga. I'm grateful that it did, though, since Golden Boy is one of my favorite anime of all time, and it means so much to me. But that makes me beg the question, why do I love Golden Boy? Why does this random-ass series that I watched on a whim mean so much to me? So, with that, I invite you to join me as we dive into Golden Boy, and I try to find out how I fell in love with such a fool. Anime-centric circles online, you can always find one of three types of anime fan. It's either the new seasonal fan, who wants to discuss the crazy new shit they just discovered called anime. And these guys are pretty much like the babies of the discussion roundtable. They're very cute and everything's brand new to them, so it's fun watching them experience things, but after a while they kind of get repetitive and you kind of get annoyed by them. Or it's the things aren't as good as they used to be type fan who thinks culture has peaked with Tenchi Muyo and is currently discussing about how Zero Experiments Lane predicted everything in our world today. Finally, there's the death cultist who only watches shows made before the Reagan administration on 17 different torrents and calls you a fucking normie for even thinking of enjoying overrated trash like Cowboy Bebop. Part of me likes to lie to myself and think that I embody a little bit of each of these kinds of fans, but if you talk to anyone that I associate with, then they would tell you that I am just a dirty fucking hipster. Admittedly, I am a filthy, filthy contrarian on some topics, mainly those that begin with M and end in Ario, but in spite of that, I feel like I am in the majority when I say that Golden Boy is one of the pinnacles of 90s anime exceptionalism. Something about it puts it in this weird void where it's simultaneously timeless, yet so distinctly 90s. Like, you can show Golden Boy to anybody and they will find something inherently funny about it, despite the stench of Tamagotchi and Bill Clinton that radiates off of it. Golden Boy is such a simple concept that the bar of entry is very low. At its core, the series follows plucky last-minute college dropout Kentaro Oe as he travels across Japan picking up odd jobs here and there in the pursuit of knowledge and pussy. The simplistic nature makes this series accessible to anyone who has a baseline tolerance for anime titties and at sometimes lowbrow humor. I feel like this is one of the big secrets to the adaptation of Golden Boy compared to the manga. By adapting the first 5 chapters, the anime allows itself to set up a solid foundation in the first episode and take the following situations to build on that cringe-inducing episode 1. While yes, the manga does this as well, the way Agawa paces it comes off a little bit rushed. Plus, the one-off type situations become repetitive really quickly. There are some really funny manga-only stories, but then there are some that just drag and they drag hard. Golden Boy the Animation is basically the strongest chapters of the manga tied up with a genuinely touching final episode that leaves the audience with a satisfying conclusion while keeping in tone with the rest of the show. Six episodes is kind of a magic number when it comes to television. For some reason, showrunners are really good at getting everything in, and it makes for pacing that sticks around for just the right amount of time while leaving the audience appeased. The exception that proves the rule. I would describe Golden Boy's pacing as steadily frenetic, despite how much of an oxymoron that is. I guess roller coaster pacing is a better way to portray it. Much like a roller coaster, once you experience an episode of Golden Boy, the next rides are more or less the same, with a few twists and turns and maybe a little loop-de-loop here and there. Basic structure works like this. There's a primary incident, the escalation, first big gag, actual conflict, series of smaller yet still funny gags, big ender, and finally Kintaro speeding off into the horizon as he is relentlessly hunted by her female counterpart of the day.
And then I slink out into the night, never to talk to her again. That's right. I separate entirely.
Oh yeah. Now, the series doesn't use that structure like gospel. There are some episodes that do actually change up the formula, like episode 3, which helps Kintaro's character, and by extension the show itself, be less stale and keep you engaged. The writing of the series takes advantage of that type of pacing by allowing jokes to be inserted at almost any time. Most of the comedy in Golden Boy is situational, and I'd compare it to It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia. Half in that I think it's the funniest goddamn thing in the world, and half because it makes me cringe so hard I turn inside out. Both of these shows have the same sense of, they aren't really gonna do that, are they? And lo and fucking behold, they done doodly dun do did it. It's that kind of cringe comedy that preys on expectation and outcome, and there are two amazing examples of this right in episode 1. The first comes when Kintaro is tasked with cleaning the women's restroom, and he begins to slip into a fantasy about his boss, and then he turns his attention to the toilet. The entire time this is happening, the audience knows where this most likely will go, so all the laughs come out of this awkward parasocial nightmare that is watching someone do something regrettable and having no input or way of stopping them. The result is about what you'd expect, and I remember the first time I showed this to editor Pat, he was squirming in his seat and had his eyes covered since he could not handle that level of cringe. The other example of this comes later when Kintaro is confronted by his boss and she absolutely loses it on him. Leading up to this moment, the episode makes it a point to play up how important Kintaro's notebook is to him in almost a Chekhov's gun-esque setup. When our hashtag girlboss finally shreds up his notebook, Kintaro is enraged and begins to lecture on the importance of such knowledge and this and that and the other thing. Meanwhile, he's just holding up a drawing of her and her frankly criminal chess beefers. This predicates itself on the idea that the audience has a rough understanding of what Kintaro was writing the whole time, but uses this impassioned and moving speech about knowledge and all this other bullshit to play with the fact that we already know that Kintaro is a dirty, dirty boy. This argument also includes my favorite gag in the whole show that I won't spoil for those who haven't seen it, but the perfection of that joke is how sharply it contrasts with all of my previous statements about setup and audience knowledge. The way the show is paced, it allows for one large joke to kick off the episode based on a few minutes of setup, and then we'll throw in one or two quick jabs that are completely out of left field as to keep the audience guessing and constantly engaged. Kintaro as a character really facilitates these jokes well as he swaps between an airhead, a pervert, a genius, a rube, a kind soul, and above all else, a fucking weirdo. Kintaro is the glue that holds the series together, and that may or may not be due to the dub. Golden Boy's dub is legendary amongst those who have witnessed it, since I am almost 100% sure that we all have the same experience. First few minutes are, oh my god, this is abysmal. Then the first real joke happens and you begin to slowly slide to the other side of the fence, where the dub transcends such connotations of good or bad, and it simply just becomes the Golden Boy dub. Unlike other famous train wrecks like the 1987 Devilman dub, which is infamous for being horrendously hilarious,
fuck you!
To the allotted Ghost Stories dub, which is just, man, fuck Ghost Stories, we're just gonna make the first Abridged series.
You see, the internet was a blessing from the Lord Jesus to spread the word of God throughout the world. But pedophiles and Muslims stole it and used its holy power to seduce children like yourself and
get out!
Not get out, get saved.
Golden Boy's English dub actually enhances the watching experience while keeping the spirit of its sub counterpart intact. Now, the show is fantastic whether you watch it dubbed or subbed, and I have watched it multiple times with both versions and have enjoyed them thoroughly, but I'd be lying if I said I didn't put on the dub for those who are unfamiliar with or experiencing Golden Boy for the first time. There's just something absolutely hypnotic about Doug Smith's performance as Kentaro. At some points he sounds like it's his first day in the booth, and at other times he sells the scene so well you'd think he was an old pro. Something about his dorky to macho and back to dorky portrayal of our Golden Boy just endears the series so much to me. The other voices in the cast do their parts well enough, but none stand out for better or for worse more than Kentaro.
My name is Kentaro Oe. I'm 25 years old and I'm a freighter. That's someone who specializes in doing only part-time jobs. Right now, I'm on my way to yet another place of employment. I wonder what it'll be like. Boy, I can't wait.
It's all in their bikes. So who needs a dick with no balls? That's why I have my little BMO baby to get me off.
BMO baby? You mean that bike?
Children could learn to use it.
That's an interesting idea.
Yeah, take a look at the delete icon. The flower in the base gets bigger every time you delete more data.
Wow. There's a little wizard at the top running a health menu. It's so cute.
So, how do you like my swimming?
Doug Smith's portrayal of this goofy, strange, but ultimately kind-hearted character is best put into words as heartfelt. Something about the scripting of the show makes his performance feel alive and just happy to be doing the job that he's doing. And frankly, that soulful feel radiates throughout the series' runtime, and it's not just the dub either. By its very nature, Golden Boy is an exceedingly warm show. It may be a raunchy arrow comedy, but it's got nothing but heart behind it. Everyone from Tetsuya Gawa to the animation staff at Studio APPP to the voice actors pouring their hearts into making you laugh your fucking ass off. Every facet of Golden Boy's production is a joy to experience. Something about that heart that is put forth in this series translates to this endless love that I hold for it. As corny as it sounds, Golden Boy not only presents an absolutely hilarious journey, but it also presents the audience with a new spin on life. The philosophy of Golden Boy is that of the so-called freighter that Kentaro describes himself as. While Kentaro is ostensibly homeless and just picking up any work he can, the series shows him as a free spirit who has more going on than you would first think. Within the series, Kentaro, and by extension the show as a whole, finds value in one of three things: knowledge, expanding one's horizon, and kindness. Even though Kentaro is a fucking moron who has committed at least 18 different sex crimes over the course of the series' 3-hour runtime, the show always makes it a point to remind you that Kentaro's actually a pretty smart dude. He may be a dropout, but he had all the requirements to graduate law school, and yet he found more value in a life of travel and learning than that of a solid, if not pedestrian, career path. Golden Boy is very Confucian in its philosophy, in the sense that Confucianism follows the ideals of education as a means of discovering one's worth or place within the world. The series uses this concept as a jumping-off point to create an idealization of a truly free life. Kentaro roams, he learns, he helps, he roams again. Much like the myth he's named after, Kentaro obtains a sense of legend throughout his exploits, and despite his rough and awkward outer shell, lies the soul of a good man. Every episode serves to reinforce that Kentaro does do good on his journey, and he changes the lives of pretty much anyone he encounters just through the simple acts of listening, learning, and being kind. Of the millions of ways I could describe Kintaro, the best word I can come up with is fool. There are two distinct meanings when someone talks about the fool. It's either the jokester, the idiot, the one that we all point and laugh at, or it's the one who journeys. We were all fools at one point in our lives. One day we got sick of our aimless meandering and wandered out into the world ready to experience any and all things that life threw at us. In that time when we were nothing but featureless slabs, ready, willing, and able to live, that's when this world was at its most magical. Kintaro is a blank slate like us, that slowly is molded into someone who could save Japan or even the world. Or maybe neither, as the end of each episode so courteously reminds us. Speaking of endings, this is all wrapped up in genuinely one of the best finales to any show ever. Golden Boy's sixth episode is an anime-exclusive story that rivals the likes of Cowboy Bebop, Fooly Cooly, and Evangelion. While yes, not being a conclusive ultimatum like the previously mentioned series in the diegetic sense, from an emotional standpoint, Golden Boy has one of the most conclusive endings ever. The episode is based around Kintaro working at an animation studio that just so happens to be adapting a super popular manga called Golden Girl, and they're crunching so hard it'd almost make a AAA game dev blush. Almost. So Kintaro brings it upon himself to call back all the previous girls from the last couple of episodes to help out and save this ship. The episode ends on the premiere of their work, and the audience is given the sense of accomplishment and also a rewarding feeling since we care about these characters despite how little time we spent with them. After the premiere is finished, everyone is left searching for Kintaro, who has escaped out the back door to further pursue his passion of studying, ending the series off on a chase as we fade to black. While this is an open-ended finale that leaves the opportunity to return to Kintaro's journey at any time, we don't need to. Some people say it's a shame that this series is only 6 episodes long, but like I said, it's perfect. It gives us enough time for Kintaro to come into our lives, change our hearts, and disappear into the horizon. Yet, this series gives us the opportunity to return and relive the whirlwind journey anytime we want. Golden Boy is an amazing piece of art that understands the key to show business is always leaving wanting more, while still leaving its audience satisfied and awed at their performance. I love Golden Boy, and I love Kintaro. Every time I return to the show, I find myself loving it more and more. I may not know where Golden Boy came from in my life, but I'm glad it's there because sometimes I've needed it. Through expert writing, masterful pacing, and a grand exit, this simple OVA showed me just how easy it is to love a fool as charming as Kintaro. My name is Michael. Let's talk again soon. Bye.